Today's date is March 27, 1996. We are conducting an interview with Mr. Marvin Zborowski. The interviewer is Anita White. We're conducting the interview in Jamaica States, USA. The language of the interview is English. My name is Anita White, W-H-I-T-E. Today's date is March 27, 1996. I'm conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. The interview is conducted in Jamaica States, Queens, USA. What is your name?
My name is Marvin Zborowski.
Could you please spell it?
Z-B-O-R-O-W-S-K-I.
Do you have any other names?
My middle name, Henry.
Do you have any nicknames?
No.
Where were you born?
I was born in Zarki, Poland.
Could you spell it, please?
Z-A-R-K-I.
And when were you born?
I was born in June 4, 1928.
Would you tell us, please, next to what large town in Poland is your city, Zarki, and how large was it?
The town of Zarki was population 8,000, which 50% of the population were Jews. The town was located 30 kilometers, in other words, 20 miles, from the town Częstochowa, which was famous for the Black Madonna. And to the south, we were close to a town of Sosnowice, which was a very industrial city.
What was the name of your father?
My father's name was Moshe.
And your mother's name?
Zisel.
What was your father's occupation?
My father was in the leather business, and we had tanneries working for us, having the finished product back to our town.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
Yes, I have an older brother and a younger sister.
Would you tell us, please, something about whatever you remember from your childhood about the city itself?
The city itself was a quite vibrant city, consisted of all various affiliations and organizations. I was too young to join, even too young to join the Scouts. I attended school. I do remember my home quite vividly. We lived quite comfortable. We had a house, our own house, which is still in existence today, consisted of three rooms plus a kitchen.
Did you have any household staff?
Yes, we did have a household cleaning lady and a woman taking care of the children.
Tell me something about the religion in your house. What affiliation did you have? And tell us something about your holidays and life.
Our family was considered as religious. We were devoted to the religion. My father was attending services twice a day. And we were going every Sabbath. The children with my father, we went to the synagogue.
Did the family get together for holidays, and which holidays did you celebrate?
We celebrated all the holidays, and especially I would outline the holidays of Pesach, which is Passover, where the family got together, and I also had my grandparents in the same town, so I used to go as a grandson for Passover. During the tabernacle holidays of Sukkot, we were blessed that our home was quite considered in those days as a luxury. We had a built-in tabernacle in the house, which is being called the Sukkah, and we even have guests in our home.
What language did you use at home?
I would say most of the time, I would say Polish, but as well Yiddish.
Tell us something about your schoolings. Which schools did you attend?
I attend Cheder at the early age of 4 or 5. then, of course, public school, which was quite obligatory to attend.
Did you experience, while you were in your public school, did you experience any anti-Semitism?
I did experience some kind of uneasiness. I would say that it was not that the children did understand what means anti-Semitism. If they came with a certain hatred or discomfort, it was only because probably or most likely they were taught at home or being told at home. Same thing goes on our behalf. Coming from a Jewish home, I don't think so that I was free to associate with the Gentile children, and the same probably the Gentile children could not associate with the Jewish children.
In the years before the war, in the town itself, are you aware if there was any anti-Semitism in the town itself, in the town proper, against, you said half of the population was Jewish?
Yes, I do remember vividly one incident, which was a very tragic one. And this was in the summer month where school, the public school, was closed, and I attended Cheder, which is the Hebrew school. In the town arrived, in the marketplace, so to say, the center of the town, a bus arrived. In those days, a bus, it was for me as a child, a novice, to run to the bus and see it. I mean, it's a bus, luxurious bus. I didn't even had an opportunity to run closely to the bus, whereby 30 or 40 young men jumped out of the bus, just destroying Jewish property, just practically beating up Jewish people, which was a very unusual thing for me and will always remember in my memory.
Well, who were these young people? Did they come from the outside of town?
Yes, I was told later on that this was an organization. They were wearing some kind of a uniform and that they belonged to a certain extreme organization, which were the anti-Jewish. I would not say anti-Semitism, they were anti-Jewish.
Well,
I did not understand the full meaning of the word of anti-Semitism.
In the years before the war, in this town where you said you, your father and you were so comfortable, did you have any sense or feeling of danger from Germany, that things were changing? And did you or anybody in town consider leaving Poland?
We did always, my father, my late father, was always speaking about the danger, obviously since the time of Hitler coming to power. And being that our town was so close to the German border, we were always worried about it. But this was not the question that we were aware. We were aware, but still in all, not every house had a radio, not every house had a telephone. And in turn, we were limited with even with the newspapers, so to say, even though that the government of Poland, as I read later years, between 1920 and 1939, that was most of the time was not a free country, it was a dictatorship under the Polish government, where no actual publications or papers could be printed at their own way of thinking. Besides, I would say, people had, even if they were aware of anti-Semitism, there was no way where to run.
Was there no immigration to Palestine at that time at all from the town?
If from later time that I was told, at a later date, that to Palestine you could only go if you were either belonging to an organization, as is from the Scouts organization, or from the extreme left of the Chalutzim, which means the pioneers, or the ones, let's say, like my father having a family, he could have also emigrated by showing that he has means to live in Israel. In other words, a certain amount of money which will give him the preference of going to Israel and settling, cultivate the land of Israel. At those days, of course, not Israel, it was Palestine.
Do you remember anything about the cultural or the social life of the town, the Kehillah, and the organizations which might have helped the Jewish population? Do you remember any of that?
I do remember quite well. The town was a very social-oriented and cultural-oriented town, starting with all the organizations from extreme left to the extreme right were in the town. Children had places where to go. We, especially being at a young age, we were very comfortable at home. We were considered one of the, so to say, wealthy people. Having a home, living in quite comfortable, having to eat quite comfortable. Even we had, every day we had from a dorm, we had a higher school of learning and Jewish studies, whereby a yeshiva boy, which means a boy which attended the higher studies, Jewish studies, came to our home and every day to have a lunch, which in those days was considered as a dinner.
In other words, you learned charity early from your parents.
Yes, my father was very charitable. Besides being charitable, he always believed of helping people, gemilat chasadim, which in other words has the meaning of helping people to establish themselves, not just giving outright as well, but giving people to be able to sustain and live a better life.
The Loan Society, Gmilat Hasadim.
That's correct.
Do you remember the first day of the war? Do you remember when it happened and where were you? Describe to us the first day of the war.
Yes, I do remember. It was September 1 on a Friday. We did not even realize. People were just preparing for the Sabbath. School year just started. It was very festive. It was before the high holidays. Nobody was, even though with the news that were coming that Germany is really arming themselves, we still couldn't believe that it is so close. Still in all, September 1, the war broke out. On September 2, which was on a Sabbath, the town was practically completely destroyed by bombs. I don't know exactly how many planes, but the city was destroyed by bombs, destructive and fire bombs. The town was practically in flames.
Were there people who were killed?
There were a lot of casualties at that day. The most interesting part is why they had to bomb this town, which was no industry, but 5 kilometers, meaning 2.5 miles, was the heaviest industry of the country of Poland, was not touched. Meaning, in other words, they knew that this belongs to them just to create the havoc of people or the scariness of war. They bombed the surrounding areas, not the industrial areas.
So what happened then?
On Sunday, the second day, so to say, of the war, second Sunday, they just simply went through like just the driving through the town.
The Germans
came in and they occupied the town, of course, creating various scary shootings, plundering, everything possible.
From the beginning.
This seemingly, as I was at that time being a boy of 11, not realizing what means SS, not realizing what means Wehrmacht or what means Germans. To me, a motorcycle or the cars were the interesting part to go and see. Seemingly, I could not go and see because at the site, they were just killing. So everybody was in hiding. Not the question of Jewish population or the population of the town, period. Then on Monday, this is in the history written, many books that I found after the war, they were considering this the Bloody Monday. The reason the Bloody Monday was that they came into town, seemingly the black uniforms, which later on we found out that this is the SS Sturmtruppes, so to say. They were killing, just merciless, wherever. Just killing.
Were they killing Jews only?
Jews and Gentiles, but most of them Jews that I could say, because the Jews lived in an area in that small town, close, so to say, within the vicinity. So the center of the town was Jewish, so this whole center was destroyed. But a lot of killings, a lot of people. Yes. And this was, I was told later on also, that this was not in our town, it's the whole area of the Chanstohov area, the old towns went through the same thing.
Now, when did they establish any government in your city? When did they start running the city?
I would say that there was no official government. One thing I have to say, even though that I am Jewish, but at the same time I'm born in Poland, there was no Polish government which collaborated with the Germans in comparison of later days and years that the Slovakian had an army or government that collaborated. Hungary had a government that collaborated. Norway had a government that collaborated. France.
But what did they do in Żarki, in your town? Did they establish a Jewish communal government, or did they have a German government, or what?
At the later date, I would say that they left the people run the, so to say, the city council, which consisted mostly of Gentiles. And the Jews, again now, established their own committee, which was also approved by the Germans.
Now, how did life change once the Germans came in? What happened?
Life changed from day one.
What did they ask you to do?
Every day there were new rozporządzenia.
Orders.
New orders.
Ordinances.
Ordinances. How to make life more difficult. And
tell us, what did they ask?
The life of difficulty was, first of all, depriving the people to exercise their profession. Most of the people were business people. So therefore, they could not do any commerce.
Why? They took away the businesses? What did they do about the business people?
Most of the businesses were confiscated. If it was larger enterprises, they put in a Treuhänder, which I would say it's a governing person which was watching over your business. Our business was confiscated. They came with trucks, loaded and everything. I do even remember that it was not the question that they were plundering and robbing and taking away possessions, the Germans. They took everything. In 1938, we finished our public school. It was a new school with new benches that I don't think so that even today there's an existence, which I do remember distinctly. Each individual student had his own bench with high polish. This school, all the furniture from that school, was in the first week of the war taken out and sent to Germany. So don't ever think that they did not know from where it's coming from. They were plundering, confiscating whatever it was movable. They took it.
When they took things away from business, when they confiscated the business, did they give any remuneration? Did they give any certificate that they took anything that they confiscated? Now, tell us about other laws aside from confiscating business. What else?
So this is the next step, how they try to humiliate the people. In other words, by taking away the sustenance and to be able to support themselves, there were no humane ways. Then, of course, people had to risk their lives and go out of the town, bringing in just stable food like potatoes, flour, just simply to be able to sustain and live. Then, of course, came the ordinance of giving away personal possessions, like, for instance, jewelry. So jewelry, people were not so eager or fast to give, so they put this in hiding, and they, it was easy to hide jewelry. Nobody's going to be that stupid or to give away diamonds if they had diamonds, or gold if they had gold.
What else were they asking for?
Then they started to come up with an ordinance, being that they were preparing for the war with Russia. They took away all the furs that the people had. Not the question of fur coats or fur lining. Anything that they had, even if it, a coat had a fur color, you had to strip your color and deliver the color to the Germans. It was Sammelstelle, that means to say it was a collecting place, and it was written down that this and this family gave so many of so many. In other words, they knew, or they were probably denouncing that, let's say, if a family was a well-to-do family, that that family probably has more than one piece or two pieces of fur, so to say, to be delivered.
Who was doing the denouncing?
I don't know exactly who did, but they must have some kind of a system to find out who is well and who is poor. I could not imagine, even if somebody will be denouncing it, seemingly that they were threatening, that they do know, could possibly also be that they did not know and they just pretending that they do know. I do remember exactly an incident when it comes to this question of furs. As I said, the people, most of the people in town were religious people, and being religious, you had to go twice to the prayer, for prayers to the synagogue. And at one time, which of course all the synagogue was destroyed in 1939, with the exception of the big synagogue, but then they established small synagogues in private houses because you're not supposed to just gather together. Being that our customs is that by having 10 people you could establish a formal prayer. So a man was walking to a prayer, and he was probably was heavy arthritis man, a sick man, and he was wearing fur pants. And the German spotted that he is wearing pants which are fur-lined. This was at the time when the ordinance was that all the furs has to be delivered to the Germans. They did not ask him to take off the pants. They did not ask him, and they just told him, you're wearing fur pants, which they're supposed to have been delivered. They killed him on the spot.
What other things were they asking the people, the Jews, to turn in, aside from jewelry and furs?
Then they did, in a very humiliating way, they gave ordinance, if you give so much and so much contribution of money, we will let you be free. In other words, free in a sense, we will not bother you, that you should give so many men for work, or so many, many more restrictions, or you get more rations. Don't forget, all the food, whatever meager part, was given to us by rations. In other words, we had little pieces of paper for rations.
Explain that a little bit in detail.
The contributions that we had to give, or so to say, to be bailed out, let's say this town population, let's say 4,000 Jews, had to deliver by the date so and so, has to deliver, let's say, 1,000,000 zloty or 100,000 or whatever an amount. By that date, that money had to be delivered.
And then explain, you said you had rations. Now explain the system, how people were fed. Tell us about the rations.
People were given rations to that they could get, let's say, 1 pound or 2 pounds of bread. I do not recall the exactly way. I definitely did not go to pick up my portion or whatever.
But did everybody in town, was everybody in town given a small
I would say
identification
they were giving
card or a Ken card? What were people given in order to receive the food?
I would say they were registered. I did not have any ID card whatsoever throughout my time being and during the war.
Mm-hmm. Were there any, if people did not have enough, were there any soup kitchens established at the time? already?
Yes, there were, people were helping. My home that I was brought up, that we always helped because we were fortunate to have certain reserves of money that we could help people. But I do remember at the time that 300 Jews were put into our town, were expelled from the north into our town. And it was on a Friday or Thursday or Friday, and they were distributed throughout the town to people who had, let's say, larger homes, so they put in a family or whatever. And whatever they could not allocate any rooms, they were actually in the gym and the school, and they were quartered there, given some sleeping facilities that they should live there.
What other things were the Germans telling the Jews to bring in?
First of all, also, I think that I overlooked one step, that all the Jews had to wear the bands with the David Star. Some other areas, let's say in our town, was the border, the German border. So on the other side of the border, they were wearing yellow David Stars with a written U there, which means Jews.
What did you have to wear, Jacques?
I had to wear a band with the star of David.
Mm-hmm. Did they leave you with the radios or any in the newspapers?
No, radios, they were confiscated in the first days. That we should be practically cut off from any news.
How did the community itself cope with the influx of the other people, or with the poor ones in town, or with the hygiene when people were sick? Tell us, what did the town do? I mean,
The community itself was stricken with various epidemic due to the situation and the hygienic problems. Therefore, we could not have any possibility to. People were dying, they were decimated. People were really without any means of living and so on. So they were really very, very poor condition.
Slate number 2, today's date, is March 27, 1996. We are conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. Mr. Zborowski, you told us about the people starving on the streets. Were there any hospitals? Were there any infirmaries? And what were the people actually dying of?
I would say that there was an infirmary, and people were really dying from starvation and as well of typhus.
Was there any fear of the disease? Was there any medical help at all, medication or anything?
There were two doctors that I too recall in the whole town. So obviously that was quite a strain upon the doctors, and I would say that there were not enough medication to heal.
Did they create a ghetto in Jarki?
They did create a ghetto whereby the people could not move out from the town. It was very difficult for Jarki to create a ghetto to resettle, being that the town was a Jewish town.
So describe the ghetto. Were there any walls, any gates, guards?
There was no walls, no gates. It was just on the outskirts of the city, on all the roads, there was police stations checking people going in and out of the city.
Did everybody have to have some sort of identification?
Absolutely.
Then?
They had to have an ID or permission to move out or go out of the city.
Well, what did your father and your family do? What did you do?
My father was a very comfortable man, as I stated before. And at the same time, while speaking about my father, I like to bring back a memory that came to my mind at the present. In 1939, when the first months of the German occupation, somehow, some way, the Germans were scared for an uprising due to the forthcoming day of Independence Day of Poland. The Independence Day of Poland was November 11. So somehow they were afraid. The occupation was just the month of September, October, and here they're approaching November 11. They came out with an ordinance and they took four hostages of the city. The four people that they took was a priest, a rabbi, a Gentile, a Jew. One Jew, and that one Jew was my father.
What did they do with the hostages?
At that date, they locked them in, and they said, if the town will not behave, or there will be any discomfort for the Germans, or any uprising, or any shootings, or anything which extraordinary, the four will be killed.
So what happened?
It was quiet. I don't know, because of the four people. Just people did not resist. My father was released.
How long did they keep them?
They kept them for 48 hours.
So now let us go back to the ghetto.
Going back to the ghetto, which people could not go out. Obviously, a lot of people started to go out without permission, without any means of papers. If they were caught, they were killed. And there was a lot of killings.
Was the native population collaborating with them? Were the guards only Germans or were there also Poles?
I would say most of the guards were Germans, with also some black police, which there were black uniforms, but there were Poles.
There were Poles. So describe a day in the ghetto. Did you have to work? What did you do?
I did not. I was too young.
Too young, but
to work.
Your father.
And my father did not have to go to work. They were taking people to various stations to work. The stations, mainly what they did work was just to keep the highway clean. The highway that ran through our city was one of the most important crossing points into the heart of Poland, and at the same time going west into the heart of Germany. So that highway, so to say, in those days, a highway, it was not a six-lane highway like in Los Angeles or California, but it was a highway, well-kept road, which they always tried to keep it clean, especially in the winter time when snow fell. That road had to be constantly clean.
So actually, what is the date of the start of the ghetto? When did they actually start the ghetto?
I would say the ghetto must towards the end, 1940-1941, and it was going on till 1942, during the high holiday period.
So most people existed just with whatever they were able to arrange themselves?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Now, describe what happens to your family. What's happening then?
In 1942, there were liquidations of the ghetto. We did say that it's really getting to be very, very resettling. I do not know if the people really comprehend that, especially myself as a child, definitely could not comprehend that the liquidation of a ghetto means that they're sending us to the gas chamber. When this came, most of the time, those liquidation of ghettos were done in a sporadic and surprising attack, so to say. They came, mostly they picked the Jewish holiday. May it be the Jewish New Year, the most sacred day of Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, or the other tabernacle holiday, Simchat Torah, the day we're rejoicing with you, Torah. That's the day that they pick for liquidation, where they really was a surprise that you could not expect anything because it is a holiday.
What happened at Simchat Torah?
Our city was destined to be liquidated on Simchat Torah. We did not know, of course, now we know that it was liquidated on Simchat Torah. We ran away from that city just the day, 8 days before. In other words, the first day before the holidays, we ran away from that city.
Why did you run away? What made you?
We got information, so to say. We got some rumors that other towns were liquidated. It was not telephone communications or any other means, but we just got rumors that this town was liquidated, this town was liquidated. So most likely that the town of Zharki probably will be liquidated within the next days or weeks, so to say. In turn, there was possibilities to run away by buying papers, getting permissions to run. In other words, there were people producing those papers from the Germans, obtaining them from the Germans authority, from the, so to say, from the county clerk or the county offices, and giving out papers to the people to run away.
Were they false Aryan papers?
No, they were regular
just permits to get away,
to move into a different section or different part of Poland.
So did you obtain any papers?
We obtained those papers for the entire family, father, mother, and three of us, and we had to run away. It was not the question that we could just sit in a car. We had to order a horse and buggy, and we went with two horses, so to say, with the Gentile, and it took us to another town.
Where did you go?
30 kilometers to a town being called Pilica, P-I-L-I-C-A.
Now, where did you hide in Pilica?
We did not have to hide. We were just, this town was already, so to say, after the liquidation of the ghetto, so to say, Judenrein, it was clean of Jews. So we were just walking around. We had permission to stay there.
But you had permission to stay there as Jews?
Permission, yes, we had permission to stay there.
Did you wear an armband in
Absolutely.
That time? Yes, you did. Then you moved freely in Pilica.
That's correct.
How long did you stay in Pilica?
We were staying there a few weeks, and then we moved back to Zharki after this town was practically also liquidated.
Were there no Jews anymore in Zharki?
There were 30 Jews left.
How did this come about? Why did they leave only 30 Jews?
30 Jews were left behind, just the few Jews which were actually the authority, so to say. And some were left behind also to clean up the mess that they created. There were hundreds of people were killed, and quite a disorder in the whole town.
When you say liquidated, does it mean, do you mean that they shot the people on the spot, or did they deport them? Did they deport them?
The liquidation of the ghetto, which I stated was the last day of the holiday of Sukkot, the tabernacle, it was that they, to the actual liquidation of the ghetto, the Germans could not round up more than 700 people.
Where was the rest?
The rest of the 4,000 ran away like our family to Pilica and all the other surrounding towns.
So what did they do with the 700?
The 700 people were loaded into horse and buggies, brought to the railroad station, put them in the cattle cars, and they were just sent into Treblinka to the gas chambers.
And now tell me, what did the 30 people who were left, what were they doing? And you said your father was among them?
No, my father was with us in the town, and we came back. Then from the 30 people, they were buying out by the Germans, stating that they do need more than 30 people to clean up the city. So in that way, they got permission to extend from 30 to 100. And that 100 group of people, our family was included for money.
So tell me, what are you doing now in town?
I was actually not between the 100 counted ones. The one that was between was my father and my mother, of blessed memory. I was in the apartment that they lived in, one room, and when they went to work, so to say, I was put between the covers.
What about your brother and sister?
Same thing.
Now,
but one day they were checking those houses for other Jews. They found my being the big man. They caught the big fish.
They caught you?
Yes. So I was 14 years old.
Where did they take you?
They took me to the local jail. I was so big and I was so skinny, so barely showing life, sign of life, so that they put me between the ladies, I do remember, and the lady sections of the jail.
How long did you stay there?
Somehow, some way, I had to be rescued during the day, but because of the next morning at the daybreak, all the inhabitants of jails were killed.
So who took you out of jail?
One of the leaders of the 30 original people came during the day and he bailed me out, seemingly that my father probably paid and he got me out.
What happens then? What happens in the town? Your father is working. Is your mother working too?
Same thing.
So now what's going on in town? There are only these 100 people.
That's correct. Then they're starting again, the 100 people, they're starting to decimate them again now. To try to make that they don't need more than 30. And they try to send away again the 70 people back to the, so to say, where they were gathering in a bigger town. What the Germans actually did, whoever escaped the first time knew that he has to watch it, but they caught him. Sooner or later, they caught him again. They did not kill, because it was a pity to use just a bullet for each Jew. It's too costly. So they tried to round up the Jews again in various places, so to say, and they put them together, and when they reached the point of 10,000, if it's enough Jews to take a train or train load, they ordered the train load of trains and again to the gas chamber.
Did they move the population from Żarków to a larger city, to a different ghetto?
Yes, they did. They moved them. So they said, here you cannot stay, but you could go back freely and live freely in another ghetto by the name of Radomsko. It's Radomsko. It's Novoradomsko. Over there, they started to put the people. As a matter of fact, that even myself was caught one day. The Germans did not know that my father works there, that I am privileged or not. I was a Jewish kid. They put me on a truck, and they just brought me into that Radomsko ghetto.
So what happened to you?
When I arrived in the Radomsko ghetto again, now being a boy of 14, I did not know where to turn. I did not know where to go. And every room that I tried to walk in, they said there's no room. And I could see there was no room. That each room was having preaches of 2-3 level preaches
in
the bunk, so to say. And there was no room for me.
So what did you do?
So I said, there's no way. I have to go back. I said, go back where? But I said, I'm going to go back. So the town of Radomsko was 70 kilometers away from my hometown. But I got an idea that the Jews who were rounded up in that truck that I was there with, they were told that their personal possessions, they were so accurate. They said, don't worry about it. Leave your possessions. The next truck will come with the possession after it. So they brought it. So it came to my mind when the truck came back with all those belongings to the Jews, I jumped and I went and I jumped on top of that truck.
And where was that truck heading to?
That truck was heading back to the town that I was born, to Żarki.
Did you reach your town?
It was quite an interesting trip to go back in that truck. First of all, I jumped at the truck. He did not know that I am in the truck.
When did he finally discover?
Then it was. I have to take a break. Yeah.
Please do. Please do.
The truck was powered by woods. So they had a certain area there where I could go into that compartment, and I went into the compartment and I covered myself. I covered myself with this just not to freeze. So while I was going on, the truck was going. I did not even realize where he's heading, but where he's going. Seemingly halfway, he stopped the truck. Stopped the truck, he gets off, and I didn't even know what town, where he is. Seemingly, I did realize there's a sign, and it said Sheriff. Small town, which I heard of it, no meaning. The spelling of it is just for the sake of the testimony. Przerow. He went in, I looked out, he went into a bar or to a restaurant. I was definitely not hungry. And even if I was hungry, I could not even ask or dream to say that I am hungry. So when he came out, seemingly that he wanted to put in more fuel into that power, put in woods into the mortar, so to say, I mean, the oven, whatever. I don't know how this being powered, anyhow. So he took a fork and to pick up some woods and to put them into the oven. So he noticed that he cannot pick up this. Somebody's there. He said, "Who is here?" So he took a flashlight and he said, "Who is here?" He said, "I am here." And I knew the man. Not that I knew that socially. I knew who he is. His name was Hajduk. I said, "What are you doing here?" I said, "Please, take me to my hometown. My father will definitely pay you that you brought me back." I mean, he knew my father, very famous name. He says, "I cannot do that." I said, "But I cannot walk out. Where should I go? I cannot go no place." So he stepped into the truck and he drove. So I said, "Okay, now it seems it's okay." We were driving close by to the city. He stops the truck and he says to me, "You have to get up." I said, "You brought me so far. I'm on the gates of the city now. Why do you tell me to get off?" He says, "Look, get up." I said, "I'm not going to get off." He said, "Get off." Back and forth, he's starting to say that I am starting to be very stubborn with him. He said, "Look, there is curfew in the city that we're driving in. I have a permit to get back to the town. The town was on the German border. The only way that you could do is just get off the truck, and I will tell you what you should do. I cannot take you. They will check the truck. They will find you. You're going to be shot and killed." I noticed that the man speaks to the point, and that he has a point, that I have no way. So I said, "Where should I go?" So he said, "Look, I will tell you what you should do." And I was seeing that he is quite reasonable. In other words, he said, "Just go straight on that road. But when you reach the gates of the city, the houses, which are practically deserted, the Jewish homes, just get into one of those houses that has the crossing and wait till you see the patrols. There's a patrol in the city, not after Jews. They're just simply killed because it's curfew. It's a patrol. So if you will see the patrol where they're going in, then you should run through the marketplace. Otherwise, you won't be able to cross that place." Sure enough, I was getting into the gate, one of those doors, and I was waiting till the patrol came.
What time of the day was that, or night?
Must have been, I would say, 10, 11 o'clock at night. Excuse me. So when I noticed the patrol going in from one bar to the other bars, there were bars for them, for the Germans.
And then what did you do?
So when they walked in, I crossed the other side.
When I crossed, you were able to do so?
To run over it. Quite difficult, but I ran over it. When I knocked at my father's house where he lived, he was afraid to open the gate of the house. He was living, he had one room, in a ground floor level. So he said, "Look, I will open the window. You will jump through the window. I said, Father, I cannot jump. Seemingly, I hurt myself. I said, I will not be able to jump into the window. So he put out a chair, and on the chair I stepped, and then we took the chair back into the house.
That's how you got into the house.
That's how I got back into the hometown.
Now, what is happening then? Those 30 or so Jews, or about the 100, still live in that city?
That still was the part of the 100, so to say, 70, starting to cut again and again. And they left again 30 Jews. They tried to expel my mother and with the children. Of course, we said we're not going to go to Radomsko. They wanted to put us again to Radomsko. My mother said adamantly, the way she heard what's going on there, and I was there, I witnessed myself, seeing that there's practically no room where to go, where to sleep, that she would not let us go. Then she found a Gentile man during the day, and she said, would you take my two children, my sister and myself? Eli, I don't know where he was. So he said, yes, gladly, I would take it. You pay me, I would take the children. As a matter of fact, he said, I'm helping another Jewish family, a Jewish man with two kids. I would gladly help you too. So I said, Mother, should I go? My sister is 2 years younger. Should I take sister and go? She said, you know what, go to your father. He works probably at this and this place. Ask your father if he gives you permission to go, because I really don't know that man. Anyhow, I walked over to my father. I said, Father, Mother tells me to go with this with a man, but I don't know who he is, what he is. Should I go? He said, my dear child, I cannot answer you the question. Do as your heart pleases you. Do it. So we went. We went with my sister. It was the most horrible year. This was 1942, 1943. That was the most severe winter. That was the year that Germany was really defeated at the point of Stalingrad. And at that point, we were walking in the snow. My sister really was not able to walk in the high snow going in and out and out. Finally, at the late evening hour, we reached the house, and we went, and he put us into the cellar. My sister was hungry. She's younger. She said, I'm hungry. I want to eat something. I'm hungry. She's starting to cry. I said, I have nothing what to give you. So I was seeing there is a Jew with two children there in the corner. I said to him, maybe you have something for my sister. I am not hungry. My sister is hungry. So he said, I don't have my own two children any food to give you or to spare. But I can give you one advice. On the other corner of the cellar, there is a barrel. Be careful, on the top of the barrel is sauerkraut, it's cabbage there. And there's a big stone. If you could push a little bit, don't push the stone. If you could push your small and skinny arm, maybe you could get out. So there was a big barrel there with cabbage, and I put my little arm in there, and I managed to get out a little bit of
strands
of cabbage, and it was sour, so I gave it to my sister, and she says, oh, that's so good, it's so delicious, so good. So we stayed there quite a few hours, and seemingly that my mother is supposed to have come too, and he went back. Instead, the same man. So the same man, expecting that mother is coming back, he brought back a letter from my father, and he said, my dear children, I want you back. I want you dearly back. Go and listen to that man. He's going to take you back to town. I knew that we won't be able to walk. He said, no, your father paid enough money. I hired a sled with horses. It was high snow, very big snow. We had a sled with horses, and he took us back into the town. I said, but where will you take us? I don't know where my father. He said, no, your father said at daybreak he will be waiting at the cemetery. So my father there standing in sub-freezing weather, waiting, not knowing exactly the time and hour when the two poor children would come. And he was waiting, and he embraced us, and he was crying, and he took us back, and he gave us a place again now to go in a house where Mother was there.
Now, what arrangements were made afterwards to try to save yourself?
So then This was already going into the end of 1942, going into the beginning of 1943, where we found out that this Radomske ghetto, this famous ghetto, was completely, 10,000 Jews were sent off to Treblinka, to the gas chamber. At that time was no way already to go any place. This was it, and my father luckily secured through negotiation probably for a long time with a good friend of my father, which he knew and befriended himself many years before, and he built a bunker in the town.
Was he a professional man who knew how to build things? Was he a builder?
Yes, he was quite a hand. First of all, he was an architect from profession himself, and he was an intelligent man. And he did it. He risked his life and his family. I want at this point just to bring out one more point, the hardship about the Poles upon the Jews. It was not the question of collaboration, of helping. The only country in Europe where a death sentence for helping or hiding a Jew was Poland, and Poland only. The Jew in Holland or in France for helping a Jew were not severely punished the way they were punished in Poland.
You mean the French or the Dutch were not so severely punished?
Exactly.
That's what you're saying. Well, describe what the bunker looked like that this man made. And by the way, what is that person's name who saved
you? The name of the person who built this bunker for us was Josef and Maria Placzek, Placzek.
Now, what did he build for you?
He built two bunkers, as a matter of fact. One, just to be able to sustain. Two, another one, in case of really danger. I will describe the first one, where we most of the time we spent. It was on the attic, whereby we could sleep there. It was cold, but we could eat and live.
How did you get up to the attic? Was there a ladder?
The house was an unfinished house, which was in a part was good, because it had no stairs, so we had a ladder.
Tape number 3, today's date is March 27, 1996. We are conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. Mr. Zborowski, you were describing the bunker, the hiding place in the attic. Would you please continue to tell us about it?
As I stated, in that house, we were upstairs, four of us. My mother, may she rest in peace, my brother, older one, myself, and my sister, the youngest. Four people were there. The condition in that place was bearable. In a way, there was no heat, but we were covered. Food, we were brought up by Mr. Placzek. It was sufficient, but it was very difficult and as far the hygienics are concerned.
When you had your physical needs, was it all upstairs?
There was no canalization or any means Therefore, it's interesting to state that the human body, whatever it's consuming, it's giving practically back the same amount. In other words, we received one pail of water, and another pail was used just for the disposals.
How many times a day did he come to pick out the bucket?
It was only done at night time. And it must say quite a big devotion for a man to do that. Every day he took down one pail of disposals. He made us very comfortable. In other words, to be able to sit down on the pail, he even created a sitting board out of wood.
Tell me, I'd like you to describe a day upstairs and tell us whether you were sitting or lying down and what you were eating and what were you talking about.
Mother was telling us family stories, which really it's not the time and place to repeat, going back from fathers and forefathers about the heritage of our people. Besides, being that Eli was 3 years older, he was somehow, some way, giving me some kind of lessons or reading books, of which I did not mention before. The town was quite culturally well established. We had a library with cases of books which were never used, and they were burned by the Germans, but the Gentile family that we were in hiding collected a lot of books, which we in turn used them during our stay in the bunker.
What did he feed you during the day?
Mainly the main staple food was bread and potatoes. And he was limited also of even buying it, because his family consisted just of one daughter. Therefore, he cannot go and buy, let's say, 5 pounds of bread when he had only one person with him, so to say. So he used to buy it in a different bakery. In other words, he went to one bakery, and then he went in the afternoon to another bakery, and he bought it.
And how many times did he come up to the attic?
I would say that he kind of must have, I would say, once. And especially to comfort my mother, because in the first months when we were in the hiding, father was still between the 30 chosen Jews to work. And as a matter of fact, in that period of time, that in the first months of our hiding in town, he came to visit us. It was a holiday, a national or religious holiday, a Christian holiday, and he was off work. So he came at night and left at night. He could not be seen that he walks into the house where we are in hiding.
How did he look to you?
He looked quite, I would say, swollen. The job that he had in the last month, they had nothing what to do. Those 30 Jews practically were just practically hostages to the Germans. They were just pressing for money. They kept them just superficially that they are needed. They were not needed at all. They should have been simply just sent away the same way as all the others. But being that there were 30 rich Jews and they were pressing constantly for money, they gave him constantly money, and they extended their stay for another month, another week. So what did they do? They were building a stable for horses. Whatever they built at daytime, they destroyed it at night. The Germans themselves, to be able to build. So how long could you build a stable? So my father was working at the section that where they were making the mortar. And this is a job outside, and probably he got kidney affected or kidney sickness, so it got swollen. So they used to call him the Folgefressener. That means to say that the full, how could I say even this expression?
Full eaten, obese. He looked obese. He looked
the
fat.
The full obese man, but yeah. In an oratory statement. I mean, I don't think that it's being used here. But anyhow, so he looked sick, but he helped. He could have stayed with us, but he was afraid.
Was that the last time you saw your
father? That's the last time I did see my father. That was in 1943.
What do you recall from that meeting?
He was so good. So protected. Practically every child at that young age had some coins, some diamonds, some kind of possession. And my mother used to cry, why you divide your possession between those small children? What do you want? But he said, I don't know where they're going to be tomorrow, or how we're going to be split up, and how we're going to be divided in different places and different so on. So therefore, I mean, he was very bright. He knew that it's no good. It's not the way. But there was no way of escaping. There was no way of getting any help. There's no way that he could have done more than he did. And if we survived, and I would say definitely by the grace of God, as I am a believer, and of the grace of my father, that he protected his wife and children, but he could not protect himself.
So after he left you, he went back to the place where he stayed?
Then one day where practically the Germans cleaned out all the towns where they called it Judenrein, meaning the free of Jews. So the head of the police or the Gestapo, so to say, I cannot keep you. I kept you, look, my dear people, and it was true. I kept you as long as I can. I have to send you away. I cannot keep you. So they were actually, every day they were counted. They had the appel, they were counted each day if there's 30, if it's not 31, if it's only 29, and so on. These countings were performed in the synagogue, the only synagogue that survived and it stays till this day. At one day, they said, this is it, and they locked them up and said, no way out. You stay here, right here, and that's it. They stayed there for 3 days. On the third day, and they were really afraid that they're going to be eventually shot because there was no way that they should put them somewhere to work or whatever. Anyhow, at the last day, or so to say, the last hours before they took those 30 people out, my father and two other young men escaped through a window, through the back window of the synagogue. They jumped the synagogue, and we, being in town, heard the Poles were stating that three Jews ran away from those 30. And between the three is Zborowski, that they glorified, that name was by them a glory, so to say. So we, in turn, were happy that he ran away. So the two young men ran, let's say, in one direction of one street outside of the town, and my father in the other. The other two were caught by the Poles, and they were brought back to the synagogue. They actually should have been shot, but the German leader there, knowing that he took from them so much possession, let them live, although they committed, so to say, a crime by running away. And my father seemingly succeeded running away, and he was killed by the Poles.
They caught him.
They got them, they killed him.
When did you learn of the death of your father?
We did not learn till this day. He never returned. If he would have survived that first days, so to say, he would have come up to our hiding place.
But when did you hear about his murder?
If there were a lot of bodies that they found of Jews being killed by Poles.
But you were now in hiding in Mr. Placzek. I'd like to take you back. You described the attic, but you said that Mr. Placzek also built for you an emergency bunker. Will you please describe the second hiding place?
Yes, the purpose for the second hiding place was that the town, as I stated before, was on the German border and a crossing point. Many times the city was visited by outside Germans controlling even the Poles. So when that kind of rations or that kind of checkings came into town, we had to go down to the cellar. In the cellar, he built a double wall, which was really a strong hiding bunker place. It was really ingenuity to establish that kind of thinking. He cut off a piece of the cellar and put, physically built with mortar and bricks, a wall which was movable on wooden wheels underneath. And in there, to be able, so we move this and we can slide in there in the back of that part.
Were you able to sit, or did you only, could, were you only standing?
We were able to sit, but there was no air. If we lit up a match, the match did not burn. It was no oxygen. It was very little oxygen.
How long a time could you have possibly stayed in that?
We don't know exactly, because we never stayed that long. But it was quite, and it was with shelves made. In other words, when we went in, we could put up the shelves, wooden shelves, and put something on the shelves and put and move the wall. We could do ourselves.
Did you ever have occasion to go there?
Yes, we had quite a few occasions. I would not say that many times, so there were quite a few occasions that we had to do it.
Describe, how did it feel emotionally to have to run from one hiding place to another place and not knowing who is upstairs, what's happening? Can you recount to us any of your emotions or feelings?
The emotions and feelings was that I was too young really to realize. I was even upset about it. I would like to scream and be rebellious. Being at the attic, one day I do remember the roof had the dachufki, how do you say it?
The slates?
The slates on the roof. So I moved one of them and I tried to look out to the world, mm-hmm. so to say. And I did see my bicycle. A friend of mine is writing, my bicycle, it's my bicycle. Why couldn't I ride that bicycle? Why? What did I do wrong? That's the emotion that I had. And also, what could I think? I did not wear any shoes. We were just wearing just rags around the feet because it was cold. We washed ourselves, still in all, we were not clean. We had a problem. Sister got once an infection and a red stripe on her arm. We could see that she may lose an arm, and there was no medication. So we had to go out, and we had to bring some medication for her.
Well, how did that happen? Who brought the medication?
He bought it, and I think that once also my brother went and bought some medication in a drugstore, but I think the Gentile did it. I mean, the man, Mr. Plachek, did and brought some medication. Also, one of the incidents that I do remember, that we were always given food at a given hour. At one time, I was just, the house, like I stated, was not finished. So I walked over to the corner of the, so to say, of the attic, and looking down if Mr. or Mrs. Plachek put the food already down next to the ladder. While I'm looking down, a little boy stares just straight into my eyes, and he starts to scream. He says, Mrs. Plachek, Mr. Plachek is upstairs. So she says, yes? Oh, that's wonderful. Then all of a sudden, this Mr. Plachek comes in, he comes home through the door. So the little boy said, how did you fly down from the roof? So I can tell you one thing, we really were very panicky after that little boy. And we were thinking, if he gets home and goes home, what kind of story he will make up, and what will he do? And what will he say? So we constantly lived in fear. We always were worried about what the next hour, not the next day, will bring. Also, one of the most important thing is that we had the situation of that my brother went out one day. We were in line of communication with relatives that were in a village also in hiding. And they wrote to us if we could help give money for a cousin, which was given away, and also by a Gentile family. So one day my brother disguised himself as a lady because he was known as a boy. And he dressed himself up as a girl. He had blonde hair. He had no big beard, so to say. He was young too. He was 3 years older. And he walked out in the market day barefoot because there was no shoes, that lady shoes could fit his legs. And he was walking barefoot in the market, going into that house and telling the people that he was sent by this and this family, by his uncle and aunt, and not, he did not say uncle, but was sent by this man, and to give money for the child, which they prepaid and so on. So that's the time when really it started. Go ahead.
You mentioned before when your sister had the infection that the Mr. Placek went to get the medication, and you mentioned something in passing that Eli also went. Did Eli again walk out of the hiding to go to a drugstore to pick up medication?
There was, if I recall, Eli left the hiding place a few times, which normally shouldn't have been done. One time, I think he went out because of the sickness of my sister to the drugstore, and one time he went also to change, to get a gold coin to sell some gold for currency. And this was the two times that I do recall that he went out.
Did he disguise himself both times, or did he walk out as Eli?
No, he did not. He was disguised.
He was disguised. Now, how long do you stay in Mr. Placek's house?
We stayed in Mr. Placek's house for 18 months.
Mm-hmm. Why did you leave it?
The problem I started to tell you, when we got this letter from the relatives to help, and Eli decided to go to help, we were a very close-knitted family. Until this day, we are very close. He went to this Gentile to pay for the child because my uncle prepaid only for, let's say, for 1 year, and now it was more, so he prepaid. And then he asked also if he could prepay if they have another place for another child. And he did not say who he is. But the Gentile sent a little boy after my brother, meaning after he was dressed as a girl. He was wearing special costumes like the peasants. And stripes, and with the pallerine.
The Polish
costume for the market day. And he went, and he was sending a little boy, and he did not know that he's being spied. So they followed him, and he went into the house of hiding. Now, there were rumors. Then a week later, he came back. And there were starting to be rumors that Mr. Placek has to do something with Jews. They couldn't dream or think about that Mr. Placek, who is a devoted Pole, and even being considered as a Volksdeutsch, which means to say that he's partially German, has to do anything with Jews. Regardless, when he went the next day, for whatever reason, Eli identified himself that he is Eli Zborowski. At that time, it means to say that a week before, when he went into Placek, that Placek has to do with the Zborowskis. And they probably maybe even there. They start to denounce Placek to the local authorities, but he was so friendly with the local authorities, entertaining them while we were in hiding upstairs, they were entertained for our money downstairs. And when they were downstairs, whenever he had company in the house, he put in a special bulb, a light, that we should behave and be quiet. Till this day, you will never hear me sneezing. Because I always, when I wasn't hiding, I had to take a little pillow and kill the sneeze and choke my sneezing, not to be heard downstairs or outside at the sidewalk.
Well,
so when he came back, the second time when he went, he did not, knowing that he's being followed, he did not come back to our hiding place, and he went to the village where the other part of our relatives stayed there. After a while, rumors were spreading unbelievable about the Placek family. So when one day Eli came back to the bunker, we decided that we have to go out. In the beginning, Mrs. Placek and Mr. Placek was absolutely against that we should leave. And the reason was quite simple. They were reasoning with us. They said, look, if you're going to be caught, the children will accept, they will definitely say where they were hiding. and she was really afraid that we will denounce her. Not because we wanted to denounce, because we were just children. So one night we decided to move, and this was in the summer months. The night is short, the days are long. We could not start to move out of the hiding until it's really late. Besides, it is a curfew, and the people were sitting in the backyards. We had to wait almost till midnight. At midnight, we started to move out. We happened to be, as small as this little town was, we were in the western part of the city. We had to go east. West was the border. We were hard on the border. It's a border. It's police. So we decided to go. The men that
where were you going?
We would decided that we would go to the hiding place, to that village where my other relatives are. So going there, we did not know exactly how to go. Mr. Placek, the man who was hiding us, dressed up himself in his honorary uniform. He was from the honorary fire department, and he put on his uniform, and so to say that he is, in case if he's being checked or being asked any questions, that he could identify himself. So he took us around that city to cross the river, and he said he would take us all the way. We keep on saying it's not needed, it's not necessary, but he kept on insisting that he wants to see us on the other side of the town. While we reached that river that I remember used to play always, jumping back and forth, that river, it was a rain probably a few days before, a week before, that river was quite deep. And it became a little bit wider, as I remember. Everybody could cross it. My mother, may she rest in peace, couldn't do it. I was wearing, it was summer month, but I was wearing high boots. Why did I wear boots? It's also silly. I had in the boots built in some golden coins, so I did not want to give up the golden coins. The boots were small. The boots were made 2 years ago. So I grew in the 2 years, if not that much. The boots, I can hardly fit in, but I got in. So finally, when I had to cross that river, I had to carry my mother. I said, look, I have boots. I would not even barely touch the water. Why don't you let me carry you? While I was carrying mother over the water, I went into the water. The water penetrated inside to my foot. I cannot walk. I had water in my boots. I cannot walk. So I'm crossing there. Time was running out on us because 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, the day breaks again. So my brother took off from one leg. He took off my boot. Maybe took me half an hour or more even to take off one. He said, I'm not going to start to take off this one. So I said, you know what, let's walk. I started to walk with the water in that foot, and I started to walk. We passed by the brick factory. We were already on the east side of the town. The Mr. Placek, the honorary chief of the fire department, says goodbye to us, crying, saying goodbye and good luck. I felt pains in my leg. We walking a little bit, and I fell down, and I couldn't walk. The whole leg got stiff, and I begged my family, and I said, look, let me die here. Just continue. There's no way that I can go on. I am just simply paralyzed, so to say, with one leg. Let me die here, continue. My brother said, my mother said, nothing doing. We will definitely not leave you here, but we cannot go on like this. We decided, day was starting to break. My brother decided, he said, you know what, I know I was there a few weeks ago. I was in that village. I know exactly how to go to that village. Let me go by myself into that village. I will try to hire a horse and a buggy. Maybe the other man has a horse and a buggy, and I will pick you up and put you on a wagon. You'll be able to walk. It's a good idea. We looked at the time. I said, Eli, it's 5 o'clock. How long will it take you? He says, look, it take me maybe an hour to go one way, an hour the other way, figure an hour to convince the guy. By 12 o'clock, definitely I will be back. 12 o'clock passed by. Let me just go back 1 second. While we were there, we didn't have anything what to eat. So we had a bottle with honey, But the bottle was dry, the honey dries. So we used to take a stick from a pine tree and dipped it there, and the mother gave each child just to suck a little bit of that honey. It was no food. Not that we were hungry, just it's a mother's instinct to give the children something. She didn't have anything else to give, so she gave just to suck this.
When Eli went back to the village, and you left, you were left with your mother and your sister, were you hiding in the woods? Were you on the riverbank? Describe, where were you?
No, we were already away from the river, deep inside inland already, inside to the east. And we were hiding in a ditch.
In a ditch.
And he covered us with branches. And he said that he knows exactly where he's dropping us off. So when it was 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the evening, we do not see Eli. And we watched how the sun goes down, how the local people, they're taking the cows in already, and they passing by, they don't see us, thank God. And we don't see Eli. Around maybe 6 o'clock or later, the sun was really coming down. Eli found us. He said, look, I'm looking for you already for 2 hours. I couldn't find you where you are.
What did he bring with him?
Instead of bringing a horse, so the horse that he thought that he was going to get, the horse was dying. And he couldn't get another horse. So he said, you know what, we will start to walk. So during the time that he was not here, I started to be able to move my leg a little bit. I could bend, let's put it this way. If I bend, I said, maybe I will be able to walk. When he came back with the Gentile, Mr. Kolach's sister. She's supposed to help. But she was so panicky, so she said, and she ran back. So we started to walk. Eli did not like it because we passed by people and they were seeing that this is Jews. This is not walking of our peasant people. We know how to walk. This is not the walking. Anyhow, so Eli decided to do it a different way. He said, let me start. I would take mother and sister first. And then I will come back for you, I will carry you.
Tape number 4, today's date is March 27, 1996. We are conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. Mr. Zborowski, your brother Eli suggested, because you were lame, that he would take mother and sister to the village into hiding and he will come for you separately. What happens then?
He did not mean exactly go to the village, it would be too far. Another one he meant to say is the following. We started to walk. Let me just retract a little bit. We started to walk. It was no way that we could walk, all four of us. It was too obvious. So he suggested that mother and sister should go with him. Let's just say for 500 yards or half a mile or half a kilometer. What distance, let's just say. He even pinpointed, he said, 15 minutes. Let me walk with him 15 minutes. I will come back 15 minutes, and then I walk with you. And then we go steps by step. All right. So I was left alone. He walks away. I'm counting 15 minutes. Another 15 minutes, I don't see nobody. So, okay, they didn't want to leave me, but I'm alone. Realizing that that's it. Maybe after an hour, I hear a whistle. subconsciously, it was dark already, in between the woods, it definitely was dark, and subconsciously I replied. And this was the lucky sign that he got closer where he heard the whistle. He said, I couldn't find you. So he found me. He said, I could. Then he's starting to carry me. I was quite heavy. He's starting to schlep me. It was not an easy thing. We're walking maybe for a half an hour. I said, Eli, where's mother? Where's our sister? He said, I tell you the truth. I don't know. So he said, look, I can tell you one thing. If I find now my mother and sister, we're not going to separate. We're going to walk as long as it may take, but we're not going to go search for each other because we're losing the time. Anyhow, that's what it happened. When we found mother, which was quite difficult in the darkness, in the woods to find, in the forest, we found starting to walk. It was very difficult to walk because it was up the hill, down the hill. I kept on asking Eli, how far is this? He says, you see over there the light? That's the light. That's the house. We got over there. He said, no, you see, that's the house. Another. Anyhow, it took us practically a whole night till we made it to that village. When we came in there to the house, the man's name was Maria and Yusef Kolach.
And what was the name of the village?
The name of the village was Bobolice. B-O-B-O-L-I-C-E. Now, that in that village, in that house, were already some relatives, two aunts and an uncle, two uncles, two aunts and a cousin and cousins.
Do you remember their names?
Yes.
The first names?
The first names was Celia and husband Semyonish, my uncle, brother of my mother, Joseph Dauman, and a sister, Rachel Dauman, and cousin, Gucha and David Yonish.
And now describe the place where all of you were hiding now.
The place where we got there, it was practically a chicken coop. It was...
Was it together with the chickens?
No, the chickens were already, the Jews were the chickens.
I see.
There were no chickens anymore. It was a small little window, small opening. The door that we walked in is from the main room. There was only one room that the men had. And one side was the stable and one side was the chicken coop. And in that part, we were there. It was quite narrow. If we had, when we laid down to sleep, 10 of us, 10 Jews, this was really just barely that one was next to the other.
Did the chicken coop have anything on the floor? Were you lying on something special, or was it just the earth?
No, it's straw, I would say. Straw. But being there, under straw, in some kind of type of a cover, or shmate, how they would say it, and was unbearable, especially the first days that we were there. The walls were infested with bed bugs, with all kind of insects, which was, in the beginning, intolerable. And the hygienic conditions were even worse than the one that we were at the 18 months that we were at the Placek and the Zarki hiding. Over there was not the question of washing. The question was over there, there was no water. There was not the question of washing. It was the question, how do we get water to boil potatoes?
Was this place a farmhouse?
This was a farmhouse and seemingly was on a hilly side where the water has to be brought in quite a few kilometers into to the house. So everything really had to be carried from far distance, actually, in barrels or in all means how to get the water. So the water was the precious things. So just to give you for an example, when the man of the house, so to say, when he boiled his meal or his potatoes and the potatoes were ready, the water was not spilled. We just add up a little bit more water and we boiled the next shift of potatoes.
What did you do about washing?
Very barely. I could remember of any washing. I would say that most of my body was like having leprosy. All the joints were really decaying, so to say. Pus underneath pus. And
did you have any remedy against the lice or the insects or the vermin?
We did not try to eliminate them, but this was practically impossible.
Describe the day. Did you spend it all the time in the chicken coop, or were you allowed to go out into the room?
Yes, he was a little bit tolerant. In other words, in the village, you could have moved around, not on the outside, of course, in the parameters of the house, which it was one room. We could walk in into his room. We could go into the stable where the horse was there, where the rabbits were there. He was having rabbits. I played with the rabbits. I mean, I was a baby. I was looking at the rabbits. Of course, I was not a baby. I was a boy. But then I was allowed to get into the Dostodoe.
To
the barn. So I walked in there. So I was playing there. I mean, it was a little bit more area. It was a little bit more fresh air.
Weren't you afraid, or wasn't he afraid, of detection by some of the neighbors?
Normally they did not visit each other. It was not the type, the peasants, that they were getting together. And we do recall that we had one really a very serious incident. The serious incident was that he went to church on Sunday. And when he went to church, nobody was in the house. He went with his family. So we, in turn, watched the house. We had a signal not to open the door. The door was not locked by any means of hermetically locked. It was just a little latch over it. So we had a system to knock three knocks to the door. And as I stated before, we could not eat together or boil or prepare the food together. So we were having in shifts. Four, and two. In other words, four Zborowski family, four the other two sisters and their husbands and brothers, and the two cousins, the last ones. So when we were finished already, and luckily everybody was inside in the chicken coop, finished already, or resting, I don't know what. I myself with my sister were in that big room, and I was looking outside if somebody's coming in. And I was looking up front, not realizing that somebody may walk in through the back. Somebody came in through the back, knocks at the door three times, and my poor sister opens up the door. A man comes in. He was flabbergasted seeing us. We were speechless seeing him. And he said, "Is Mr. Kolach home?" We said, "No, he went to church." He said, "Goodbye." He left. I don't have to tell you that this was really Tisha B'Av, the day really of crying and lamenting. What did we do? Of course, we did not blame sister for it, but we really were scared. When he came home, we had to confess to the man. We cannot just simply say nothing happened. We told him. He said, "Look, I'm very upset about it, but I have to think something about it. I have to do some really thinking." He liked very much my brother, and he spoke to my brother, and they came back after a discussion that the best thing will be to, at night, at the late hour, meaning not, so to say, before midnight, that we should go out to that group of houses in the village, of the group of village that we are, and scare off a little bit the people.
Who is the we?
Meaning we, he meant to say the following. Nobody knew Eli, my brother. He looked like a Gentile in the beginning. He had blonde hair and so on. I had another uncle that had also very light complexion. And he said, and he organized that my brother, two of my uncles, and myself is four. He himself is five. One man was sick, he couldn't go, so we were five. He said, "We have to go, five of us, in showing that we are some type of partisans or pretending that we are partisans, and to scare off the people in that group of houses." scaring off, not by, God forbid, of doing something bad to them, just scaring them off. There should be no denunciation of any thinking and any collaborations with the Germans. It was a crazy idea, we really thought, but it turned out to be, it was a very wise idea. The man, which I have to say, was illiterate, but was highly intelligent. If he could have thought of it, and of hiding and helping and feed 10 Jews, how to bring in food to one of the very remote places where everything that a cup of water was a problem, and to come up with that idea of saving Jews, and then come and go out and scaring his, so to say, his people, it was a great idea. So we decided, and he said, I want you to go into each house, not to ask for anything. Usually the partisans in the past used to come into houses asking for food, for chickens, for all kind of means of food to be able to feed the partisans. So we did not ask for anything. We did not want anything. So we were really the good partisans, so to say. We did not want anything. So what did we want to do? So when Eli walked into our house, he just asked, what is the name of this household and how many people live in that household? And in case of an invasion of the troops, how many people would they be able to station here? That's about all, and wishing him all the best.
How did all of you walk in with Eli, or just Eli alone?
No, if we would have walked in with my other two uncles, they would definitely see that they are Jews. There's no two ways about it, even including myself, which I was an invalid. I was barely walking. I mean, I was already a few months later. I was barely walking properly. So he said no. He said, I will guide you. I'm walking with you. Only Eli will go in. His name was not Eli. His name was Ignash. And Uncle Joe, he will go in, and you will write, you will speak.
But the peasant himself did not walk in.
No way. But the only thing, he looked into the windows. So when he walked in, so my brother started to say, what is the name of the household, and how many people, and again the same thing. And then he wrote down, and we moved into the next house. We moved into the next house and did the same thing. Then all of a sudden, the peasant that was hiding us said, look, there are strange people and that some girls over there, you know, some girls are playing around there with the men. I mean, what are those girls? Those girls don't belong in that house. So he said, call your brother out. So I'm not going to say, brother, come out. So I said it in a military way. He told me how to say it, Odmarsch, meaning just move out. Moved out, and I said to my brother, I said, no, he's Mr. Collins saying that those girls don't belong in his house. Better identify them, try to identify. Mm-hmm. Walked away, said, I want you to identify yourself. Are you strangers in this town or are you village? No, I'm from the same houses. The next Sunday, so we scared him off. We didn't take anything. As a matter of fact, that one of the last places that we went, the people were really appreciating that we're giving him so much courage that the war is towards the end, and it was, so to say, towards the end, that they gave us, they prepared already for Christmas the special cake, which is being
stolen.
Special cake made for Christmas. He said, you know what, we will share with you, take at least part of it, of the holiday cake that we baked. You are our brothers, and let's hope and pray that the war will be over soon. And the next Sunday, when the peasant again now, Mr. Collard, went to church, the priest even said, look, this week we had visitors, the real partisans were here. They did not plunder, they did not ask for anything, but they only said that we should be patient, we should not denounce each other, we should be happy, and that the war would be coming to an end. This was the real partisan, that was us.
That is a fantastic story indeed. Now, how long did you stay with Mr. College?
We stayed there for almost a half a year. This was already before Christmas. We were liberated in January 17, 1945.
Please describe that.
We were liberated by the Russians, and the night of the liberation were a very emotional one and a very exciting one. the area, like I stated, it was close already to the German border, and it was very fierce fightings, and there was some trenches made around, not exactly in the village, but on the outside, double trenches, so to say, in the trenches were full of Germans. And the night, we did not know, we did not have any radios or any means that the front, so to say, that the army is 5 kilometers or 10 kilometers away, but the area was very much indeed with full of partisans, and we did not know which one is the real one, which one is the other ones. There was a Armia Krajowa and there was Armia Ludowa, which it means was one was an AK army, which was sympathetic to the Jews, and one was not sympathetic to the Jews. So the Armia Krajowa definitely was not, and Armia Ludowa seemingly supposed to have been sympathetic to the Jews. So anyhow, we were watching at night. It was my night to watch at night if we see somebody approaching, because if somebody comes in, we should know and run in to the hiding. I forgot to mention also that in the chicken coop, he built a hole for in case of an inspection of Germans coming to the village to stuff us in into that things. It was really not made for 10 people. It was just barely where we had to go in there. It was really that we could stand one against the other in a standing position. That's about all. Also, no air whatsoever. Now, when that night that I was watching, I did see some really fire pieces of bombs, so to say, and I could hear it, swishes coming into the fields. I really did not know, or I did not experience that kind of fighting or anything of approaching an army or whatever. I was scared. What do I do? So I walked over. The man was sleeping in that room where I was sitting at the window, and I walked him up and I called him. I barely touched him. I was afraid that he may hit me by waking in the middle of the night. And I said, Mr. I see some fire falling in our fields, and I don't know what it is. He says, good, you woke me up. I said, I'm sorry, I woke you. No, it's good, you did right. He walks out, gets dressed, walks out, and he says, the Russians are closing in. The front is here. So he said, tell everybody to get dressed, whatever it is, because I want you to get into the barn and into the cellar. So we went into the barn and the cellar. A few hours later, he came and he called my brother. He liked him very much. He said, Ignaz, Eli, you always dreamed to have a machine gun. A German is here now in the house. He wants a pair of slacks. He wants to change to civilian clothes. He wants to run away. He wants to give you the machine gun for it. My brother was ready to give him the pants. Yeah, machine gun. Everybody was starting to say, well, you're a little bit older than him. Stop it. This front can move east and west, and then he come back that he left here the machine gun. We didn't want it. We send him away. Another couple hours later, the peasant knocks at the door from the cellar, and he says again to my brother, I want you to come up. The Russians are in our backyard. So, of course, everybody wanted to run up. He said, no. Only one at a time. One. So that's the way it started, and we were liberated by the Russians.
Did the Russians accept you right away as Jews who were in hiding and survived, or were they
happens
skeptical?
Happens to be that at that place there was the general kitchen that they had, the field kitchen from the army. We were fed properly. Of course, there was good food. Of course, we were very careful not to eat, which was good, because otherwise we would have gotten sick from the fat thing. But they did not have a chance to ask. We did not have a chance even to see him properly. They moved out. They eat and they moved. That was the front line. They just broke through. And we did not see nobody, horses and just tanks, and just were just moving.
What did you do?
We were staying. We did not know what to do. So when this was at the daytime, now let's say in the evening around 4 or 5 o'clock in January, day short, the fighting started really. The trenches that started to open up the fire, one against the other. So the village that we were part of the village that we were in were just in between no man's land. In other words, in one part was the Germans, in one part was the Russians, and they were fighting just one between the other. And we, in those houses in the middle were just burning hell. And we could not stay in the barn because there was no fireproof cellars that was just simply would blow up like in no time. So we said to the peasant, we want to get out. And we went out.
So
and we were walking in that no man's land, full of ammunition or bullets going swishing through our heads. And we walked into another village. And that other village had already the Russians established, so to say, was the second line in command. And one of my cousins said, we are Jews. I said, Jews what? No, I'm starting to say too much. We didn't want to say anything. We started to be in that village.
So you stay. Was that village now free under the Russians?
It was free under the Russians, but still they were skeptical and they were reluctant to accept us.
So what did you do?
We spread. We said it's no good that we walk 10 people together, and we spread out in three groups again. Now we walked in. And we did not say that we Jews. Just the opposite. We said we not Jews. We did not say not Jews. We said we came from another town, which was actually bombarded, and there's a fighting going on there, and just whatever. There were some other not local people. There were out of town people in that village, and seemingly they were from Warsaw, and they said they were starting to murmur to each other, "Those are Jews. Those are Jews." Okay, we were not too comfortable about it, but we felt there's no way now to go to any discussion or anything, to run to hiding. The Russians are here. Then after a couple days, a day staying in that village, we went back to our hometown that we were born and raised into the hometown of Zarki.
How long did it take you to get from where you were to Zarki?
We were hitchhiking with the Russians, and they took us into town. Must have been a few hours just to get into the town.
Now tell us, what did you find in town?
We really found in the town really disappointment. Nobody was waiting for us. Nobody was greeting us. The war was not over for us. We had no place to go.
Did you try to go to your own home?
The house that we had was a nice home. There was somebody lived in the house. You cannot just
Who was living in your house?
I don't remember the name of the people, but I know that they lived there, and but they did not move out in the beginning.
What nationality were they?
They were Polish. They were.
And they would not move out?
No. Eventually, my mother pleaded with them. She said, look, I do not need four rooms. What I really need is just one room to be able to sleep, and the kitchen we can use just to share it. So he really could not refuse. So he said, how could I refuse you? Said, Mrs. Borowski, you are actually the owner of the house. Can I refuse you? He says, that's nice of you. So my mother even said, not the question of no. And there was plenty of Jewish homes that they were empty. Maybe they were not as nice as this one, but they were.
So what did you do?
Then we moved in into the house. And Eli, of course, went out to school, to lodge, to the second largest city. And I stayed there with my mother and my uncle and aunt. And then in May, my brother and sister, they already left Poland, and I remained with my mother in the town.
Where did your brother and sister go?
Seemingly, they were told that they, on their false papers, on their illegal way, they would be able to go to Palestine.
And they set out for Palestine? And
they set out for Palestine, but they got stuck in Germany.
Now, you and your mother, what do you do in town?
What I try to do is, being a young boy, I try to register to school, but somehow, somewhere, there was a reluctance to be accepted, even to finish my public or to go to high school. I was not welcome. I was not welcome to. No.
Did you have anything that you have hidden before you left that you were thinking about, or that your father might have left you some ideas about things?
Yes, we did. We did. It happened to be that I was the one that my father took me to to show where he is hiding. And he, I mean, relatively speaking, going back today, living today in America, it's what means money. I mean, it's so relative to say how much means money, money. But in those days, I felt my father was hiding boxes of gold, I mean, and coins and all kind of precious things. And that was the main reason why my mother wanted to put a foot in the door and to be able to get into the house. And we succeeded in a way that after a few months, the Polish family moved out from the house. There was plenty of Jewish other homes. And we occupied the four rooms. And one of my aunts in the house was really plundered. You could see that the plaster of the walls was removed in searching for valuables, because this was Zborowski house and that they were looking for valuables. So I was not in a hurry to go to look for these possessions because I knew it's not there. If they were just taking off the mortar from the walls, the bricks were removed, so I'm sure that they found it. Anyhow, one of my mother's sisters kept on insisting, go down, look, you know exactly what corner it is. And I went down, it wasn't a corner, let's say, this is the basement. And the corner was there, and I started to dig, and I digged underneath the foundation. And this was put underneath the foundation. Now, underneath the foundation, again on the outside of the foundation, I couldn't dig from the outside because there were the stairs there, like the stairs, let's say, in this house, so were underneath. So I was digging. It was water coming. I could not find it. I could not find anything. And I got tired. I came back up. Went again down. I digged again a little bit. Again. One day my aunt was really persistent and she said, I want you to continue. And I continued. And sure enough, I found it. It was 10 boxes with gold and all kind of precious metal. It was actually... the tin boxes were rusted, and the reason why I couldn't find it is because seemingly I was told that the soil is moving after years. But I found everything.
And you were able to take those things out?
I took it out, everything, yes. Mm-hmm.
Tape number 5, today's date is March 27, 1996. We're conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. Mr. Zborowski, now that you have found that hard-earned money of your father's that he saved there for your family, you found it. What's happening next?
Next, it was quite difficult, even having the possessions. How do you make a living? I want to go to school. I want to be somebody. And I have to earn some money to support my mother. I didn't have my father.
So what did
you do? So I started to go on markets, so to say, and to earn a living. I was waiting till after the high holidays and to make up my decision what to do, to follow, to go on the road with my brother and sister, went to Palestine, or what actually it's going to be. The day before the high holidays, we were still in our house. There were two Jewish families in the town that survived. that they came back and made their home in that town. Nobody from that town came back. Very few from the 4,000 Jews survived. I have no boy or girl of my age that survived. It's quite difficult to make your home in that home. Regardless of saying, the night or the day before the high holidays, not Arab, a day before, it means to say practically 2 days before the high holidays in Rosh Hashanah, grenades were thrown into our house, destroying the house and destroying the other house, the two Jewish homes that the Jews survived. They gave us indication you not wanted.
Who threw the grenades?
If I would know who threw the grenades, I would definitely try to prosecute them. But I can tell you, rest assured, that there were Poles. There was no more Germans. And we realized that this is not our place.
So what did you do?
So the safest place was that the Jews tried to congregate or to live in areas in bigger towns. And up till this day, I consider that Poland is a forbidden country to live, a Jew to live in a provincial town. If there are Jews today in Poland, they are only there in Warsaw, Krakow, and another few, Lodz perhaps, but not in other towns. So we moved at that time, expelled before the high holidays, we moved into Sosnowiec. Over there we stayed a few months, and we started to move to the border area and to run away.
So which border did you cross?
I tried to cross a few borders and I was caught. And I know the time is limited. And I will just mention the border that I crossed, and I succeeded to get into Leipzig, to Germany, to East Germany.
So which borders did you have to cross to get to Leipzig?
We crossed the border at Görlitz. And we crossed the border there to Dresden. From Dresden, we went to Leipzig. From Leipzig, we had to cross to West Germany. In West Germany, we arrived at the beginning of 1946.
Where did you arrive?
Being that my brother was already in Feldafing, this was a displaced person camp for Jews, and I joined my brother in that camp.
I assume then that you were in touch with your brother, since you said you knew where your brother
was?
Yes,
by mail.
Now describe your stay at Feldafing. Did you finally go to school?
Yes, in Feldafing we lived in a villa, so to say, one room. There was in that villa was former German family lived before, and the rooms were divided and given to each family a room. Being in that room, I registered and I applied, and I was going to a vocational school, and I felt that the only way to do it is to learn the trade, and I was starting to apply, and I was accepted to a dental mechanical school.
Who was the head of the school? I mean, who was sponsoring the school?
I think that this was a Jewish organization. I think it was the OAT. Now, going in that, I did not find this quite interesting, and I said I would like rather to prefer to go through my general studies and get to higher education. So I was going through speedy courses, going through school, and applying to Munich in München, Germany. It's in Bavaria, which Feldafing is also part of Bavaria. And I applied to the Oscar von Miller Polytechnicum at the Polytechnic School of Engineering in Munich, Germany.
And you were accepted?
I was accepted. And I was one of the youngest one with another friend of mine. We were one of the youngest one. I also did not feel comfortable in the school because my schoolmates were former military people. They were still wearing uniforms without the badges, of course. Mm-hmm. I was very uncomfortable.
Who were they? Were they Poles or Germans? Or
no, they were Germans.
The Germans.
Because the Polytechnic had a limited amount of space for students. So they were really actually the one that had the preference, and also the one who were actually, during the war, prosecuted or discriminated, so we got the preference. While speaking about education, I have to go back to one segment of during the war of 1941-42, where there were no schooling in our hometown, Zarki. And I'm happy that I'm speaking about education, and this is very, very important for me, whereby the Jew was not allowed to go to school. My father, with another few friends, hired a teacher, private teacher, that came from another town, from Plotsk. I even remember her name, Judy Huvna. I even have a picture of that school class of, I think we were six children, and she gave us courses, speedy courses, which I would definitely say that a lot of those courses still remain and being used by me today. Mainly what I did grasp or learn was the German language, which I'm fluent in it, and this helped me to get into the Polytechnic as well. This in turn also helped me, being in the Polytechnic, getting this higher education, that I grasp again. I'm not saying that I do not speak with an accent, I'm not saying that I'm full command of the language, but I would definitely say that I do feel, and maybe I would have to correct myself, I'm in command of the language of English.
You certainly are. Now, how long did you stay in the Polytechnic?
1 year.
While you were studying at the Polytechnic, did you live at Feldafink in the DP camp?
No, the DP camp was liquidated, I think, 1949 or 1950. The liquidation of the camp, and I lived in Munich, Germany.
And your mother lived then with you in Munich as well?
No, my mother, going back now, my sister finally arrived as an illegal immigrant to Israel, the illegal children, the first illegal immigration to Israel by the children. My sister was in that group.
To Palestine.
After the establishment of the State of Israel, obviously my mother wanted to go to her little girl. So she emigrated in 1950 to Israel. We, in turn, wanted also to emigrate to Israel. It's not the question I had anything against the United States. I had nobody to claim that I should be able to go to the United States. I have no relatives in the United States. So my heart was set, or my plans were set to go to Israel, but I did want to finish my school. But at the time that I was going to school, to the Polytechnic, the Jewish organization, the Hayas, the American Jewish Congress and Jewish Committee were constantly calling upon us to move out. It was the Korean War, to get out because we are standing before a third world war, and they would really like that we should move out of Germany. So the question was now, where do I go? At that time, of the grace of God, of course, and of the graciousness of our late President Truman, which I think he was a great humanitarian, and I have to state, not Roosevelt. I would underline three lines, because Roosevelt was a great man, and as far as the Depression time, helping the American people, which he did, is right. But as far as humanity is concerned, I would say that Truman was one of the greatest presidents, and by establishing the Displaced Person Act, and under that act, I was privileged to come to the United States.
Did Eli come with you?
Eli came a few weeks later. I arrived in the United States on January 27, 1952, and Eli arrived, I think, a few weeks later.
Now, where did you go?
It's a very interesting story, the day of my arrival.
Tell us.
The day of my arrival was very bleak. It was a rainy day, and January 27, to arrive in New York, very, very, very uninteresting, especially where do I go? What should I do? So my contract was actually that I had to go to Philadelphia. I applied to Philadelphia, and I was happy to go to Philadelphia because Philadelphia, I had a friend there that lived in Philadelphia. I wanted to go to Philadelphia. I had nobody somewhere else. Of course, I had people in New York. Being that I wanted to go to Philadelphia, the person who waited for me was from the Hayas, and he said, Mr. Zborowski, you're going to Baltimore. I said, I'm not going to Baltimore. I'm going to Philadelphia. She said, no, you have to go to Baltimore. I said, look, don't start up with me. I'm a very nervous kid. I'm not going to Baltimore. I'm going to Philadelphia. You have to. I said, if you have to, if you could change, then I want to change to New York. Why do they want to go to New York? All the refugees, all the foreigners, whatever the description I have, I'm very proud to say that I'm a refugee. Of course, people, my friends, I keep on saying, being here in the States for 40, whatever years, you still consider yourself. I said, that's the way I came. I came as a refuge boy. I mean, there's nothing you can do about it. So anyhow, I said, if you could change to Baltimore, you could change to New York. I said, why do you want to stay in New York? I said, because I have somebody here in New York. Anyhow, to make this a little bit shorter, she gave me the permission to stay in New York with the provision that I will not ask for any assistance and any benefits from the organization because I refuse to go to the place of destination to Baltimore. I said, I do not need anything, and thank God I did not need anything. And as a matter of fact, I paid back my passage, which I got through the organization. I paid everything 10 times over for the graciousness of bringing me back, bringing me to the United States.
But please bring us into the picture. You are arriving in New York. You don't know anyone. You don't speak English then yet.
Not at all.
Now you're lost on the moon. What do you do?
I was never scared for anything.
Well, tell us about you.
When finally she called me away in the side, she saw that she has a hard neck, that I'm a stiff-necked kid, so to say, obnoxious one. She said, you want to stay in New York? I said, yes, absolutely, yes. And, okay, so stay here, be quiet. Okay, I said, I will be quiet. Can I stay in New York? She said, yeah, you could stay in New York, but be quiet. I said, I will be quiet, I promise you. I said, but don't have the last word. I have the last word, okay. Anyhow, she came over to me and said, you could stay in New York, and you can go if you wish. I said, yes, I have some belongings, and I'm not going to walk with belongings. I don't know what means a taxi or whatever. I said, why couldn't you take away from me whatever I have in storage, and I would take a small suitcase, and I would go with that. Okay, so this could be granted. She took and gave me a receipt for all my belongings, how many pieces I had. And I don't have to tell you, I came as a young boy, but I was like coming like being a bachelor. Eli was married before, so whatever his wife bought for herself, she bought for me. So I came like I would be a divorced or a bachelor man, prepared with all kind of dishes and porcelains and crystals. And don't ask what I had, like I would be really equipped. And here I come, a young man in the, so to say, in the early 20s. Anyhow, so when she took away from me the things, and I'm walking, she calls me back. She calls me back and said, tell me. And I see that she is crying. She says, where are you? You really know what you're doing? I said, yes, I know. I said, but you're going to walk out from this building. Where do you go? So I said, I will make my way. Anyhow, she said, look, you're going to, and I told her I'm going to this address, that address, whatever it is. So she said, look, what happens if the people will not let you sleep? Here you have a voucher for one night, not for two nights, for one night. So thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I never used that voucher.
Where did you go?
I went to some friends. They were nice enough. Then later on, I established myself. I worked for $30. 6 months later, I was in the States. I was in business. And I'm in business till to this day.
Well, what was your first job? What did you do?
My first job is very interesting. In those days, the minimum salary was 75 cents. It means to say 40 hours, I got $30. I mean, gross income, $30. I was not worth it more. Don't think that I was complaining. I did not complain. I don't think so. I was worth it even $30.
What were you doing?
I was pressing heads.
And then 6 months later?
Then the man said, look, you know how to write and how to read. I mean, you don't have to press head. I mean, we'll put you in the office. And I was seeing what he was doing. So 6 months later, I said, you know what? I can do a better job than you do. And I bought 40 machines and I made myself a factory.
How long were you in that business?
I was in that business. I was from 1952 to 1956, 57, 4 or 5 years.
And then?
Made a lot of money those days.
And then what did you do?
And then, of course, being that I was a young man, so I married in 1954. I married Selena. We had a blind date and...
And you fell in love?
And it worked. The only thing is I met her before and I had to wait till she got really mature to be my wife.
And
she's a few years younger.
And then you went into your own business? Which one?
Then we joined. I joined with my brother. We went to the export business. And since that time, we are together.
Now, tell us something about your family, your children, your grandchildren.
Before we going into the family, I just would like to speak about the success of the business. And then
please
just
do.
Make it in one sentence. We went into the export-import business, and then eventually we became the distributor for the Shoah Pen Company. And up to this day, we're still representing the Shoah Pen Company in certain Latin American countries. We had factories in Argentina, Brazil, and Mexico. As well, we were in the knitting business. Not knitting, just making, remaking. We were making our own fibers in Brazil. We had a factory that I was involved that we had 2,000 people. We were 50% shareholder in that factory.
And were you in any other businesses in this country?
Then, of course, I was also involved in the construction business. A lot of homes in this area that I built, especially in the Borough of Queens. And I was also, and up till this day, I'm also in the banking business. I'm a shareholder of a bank. I was representing, being in Switzerland and at Swiss Bank, being in a board of the corporate, of the bank corporation.
Now tell us something, since you are so successful, how are you giving it back to society in your social work
in
and
turn,
philanthropic work?
In turn, being, thank God, being to the grace of God, being successful, I shared my wealth. We established an endowment. My children went to Queens College. We made an endowment to Queens College where lectures are being given in the name of Selina Marvin Zborowski. I also am part of the Yeshiva University underdisciplinary chair of Holocaust Studies under the name of Diana and Eli Zborowski. I'm on the board of international board in Jerusalem of Yad Vashem. I'm serving on the board of directors here in the United States of the Friends of the Yad Vashem. I'm involved politically supporting both the Republican and the Democratic Party, whereby I have no personal gain, not from one, not from the other, which is not tax deductible, not at all. I'm involved in communal life belonging to the synagogue, to my local synagogue. I lived in Jamaica. I'm living in Jamaica now for the last 3.5 years. I lived before for 30-some-odd years in Hillcrest, where I was an officer, builder, founder of one of the largest Orthodox community, modern Orthodox communities in the United States. We had over 500 vibrant families in our community.
Are you also involved with any of the universities? Are you on boards of universities?
Yes, I'm on the board of the Queens College.
Are you involved with any of the Holocaust, the Shoah observances, or?
Yes, all since the day, they're always involved at the commemoration of the Yom HaShoah. I was the one who installed the first one in our community in Hillcrest, and it's being perpetuated every year. And also, it's being followed the same way here where I am now in Jamaica States.
Now, would you tell us about your beautiful family?
My family is really a lovely family. We are very close. The children are very close to us, and we are close to the children. I have two wonderful sons. They are married. I never had the privilege of having daughters till they got married, and I have now two daughters, which just like daughters.
And how many grandchildren do you
have? We have three, and now one was born this week, which
Mazal
is four.
Tov.
Thank you very much. It's four. He's 3 days old. And let's hope and pray that everything will be okay, that we can go and proceed and enjoy the pleasures out of the children. The children, the older one is Mark, which he came after 7 years that we were married. We always speak about it. The children were not easy, not that we didn't plan, not that we didn't want to. We wanted children, but the first one came after 7 years, so we appreciate them much, much more.
Mr. Zborowski, you feel that your Shoah experiences, the experiences during the Shoah, have influenced the way you look at the world and at people and you view life?
Definitely.
Tell us.
I would say the experience that I have is, first of all, for humanity. I'm a very liberal-minded person in respect of equal rights for everybody. I do not consider myself that I am better because I accumulated, relatively speaking, a comfortable position in my life, or that I accomplished a position in, politically or communal or even in any endeavors. I do feel that if everybody would have gotten the possibility in seeing what I went through, education, everybody could make it if I made it.
What are your feelings about the future for you? Would you like to tell something to your children, your grandchildren, and the world at large on the basis of your experiences? How do
Very good question, but I will word it before, just inject one word about the past.
Please,
and to be able to get into the future. Without the past, we will not be able to continue our future. The past experience that I had with the people that I live, and I do consider myself that I was born in Poland, that I'm a Jew born in Poland. I could not deny, neither do I want to deny, but I do say it, that the guilt that the Polish people have, and they should come up, and they will eventually come up, is because they did not have the education. They were not educated to understand to be equal with all their citizens of their country. In other words, I do say, if the Polish people would have a better education, there would not be that much hatred. The great part of it that the Polish people had, and I want to have it on record, the only education that the Polish people had is to go to church and to listen to what the church is saying. Therefore, the church has a big part. Don't blame the Poles and don't blame anybody. Blame the church for the unfortunate. We are blessed now with a great Pope, which happens to be born in Poland, the country of my ancestors. But I was expecting, he's doing a great job, fantastic job. He's the only Pope that history could show that is moving, is movable, doing things. He's a doer. But at the same time, he should do something for humanity. And it's being proven and being repeated again. And that's where I'm getting into the future, which is going on now in the country of Yugoslavia. What kind of war is there? It's a war of the churches.
Mr. Zborowski, those two wonderful Polish families whom you are so grateful to, what did you do for them in gratitude?
In gratitude, we always remember them and we'll never forget. We try to support them till this day. Of course, Mr. and Mrs. Placzek died. When I came back after 40 years to Poland, the first thing what I did, I came to town, I went to the cemetery to pay the respect to the Mr. and Mrs. Placzek. The other one that we were 6 months, we had still the privilege to see him after the war, and we took him to Jerusalem, the same way we did with the offspring of the Placzek. He had only one daughter. Until this day, we're supporting her, helping her, and we also took her to Jerusalem and to be inscribed and be planted in the valley and in the alley of the righteous.
So both, you saw to it that both families
both
are
Both families
inscribed.
Are recognized as such.
Mr. Zborowski, we want to thank you very much for sharing your experiences with us. Thank you very much.
It is my privilege, by the grace of God.
Mr. Zborowski, it was obviously such a great honor to have your friends who saved so many lives, Jewish lives, have them have the trees planted in the alley of the righteous. But you were going to tell us something about your thoughts and ideas about the future.
While speaking about the past, I would like to get into the present and the future. The present, what we try to do is to establish as much as possible, like I would admire the graciousness of people like Spielberg and many others, would try to perpetuate the memory of the Kedoshim survivors, and especially of the Kedoshim, of the martyrs that they got killed. I would only say, with the help now, with having the, so to say, the possibility of establishing museums or places of learning about the Holocaust, which is a great, great achievement. And I strongly feel that the especially the Yad Vashem in Jerusalem, which is a remarkable, an outstanding piece of collection, of, and it's being growing and more because it's expanding of so much more and more material, and even having all these dates, and especially the Washington Museum and the New York City plans for museum, and there's many other towns and cities of museums, is just as good as I'm supporting, and I'm all for it, because people should not have any doubt about it, what it really happened, and by remembering, then we definitely will know that it should not happen again. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I will try to, as long as God will give me the years to live, to remember, and I could not forget the years of horror, and I will try to perpetuate for the generations to come. Thank you very much.
Slate number 6, today's date is March 27, 1996. We are conducting an interview with the survivor, Mr. Marvin Zborowski. Mr. Zborowski, would you please introduce your family through your family photographs?
This picture is great-grandfather being taken at the turn of the century, and the name is Moshe Daumann, being called the Groisse Moshe.
Where was the picture taken?
Taken in Żarki, Poland. Significant about the picture is that he is wearing a galut hat, which was a typical hat in that part of Poland. This is my grandfather and grandmother on my maternal side. The names are my grandmother, Esther Daumann, and Samuel Daumann. They were killed in January 1943 at the railroad track.
And where?
In Radomsko, Poland. This is my father, Moshe Zborowski, and my mother, Zisel Zborowski. My father was killed in August 1943 by the Poles. My mother died in 1963 in the United States of America.
May I just say something?
This picture was taken in 1923 when there was their engagement. My father was killed in 1943. And my mother died in 1963. This picture was taken in the early 20s when he was attending the Yeshiva High School.
Who is this?
My father, Moshe Zborowski.
Where was the picture taken?
Taken in Żarki, Poland. This picture was taken in July 1935. At the time, one of our relatives went to Canada. Sitting from the left side, my brother Eli, my sister Sasha, myself, cousin Helen, and uncle Moshe. The second row, two of my aunts, Sala and Rachel, and the third line from left to right, my late mother, my aunt Sasha, my uncle Sam, cousin which left for Canada, and my aunt Bella.
And your mother's name?
Cecil Zborowski. This picture was taken during our time we went to a spa, and I am with my parents, and it was taken in August 1939. My mother, Cecil, on the left, myself in center, and my late father in Strawnica, Poland. This picture was taken during the war, and significant about the David Star of my aunt wearing or holding it. From my left sitting, my cousin Helen survived, my aunt Salcha killed, and my sister Sasha survived. This picture was given to me by my uncle, which survived, and this picture was taken in 1942, where it shows a group of Jews with their gear being taken to clean the roads, which was so vital for the Germans.
What city is that?
Sarki, Poland. This picture is very significant and has a great meaning to me. This was at the time taken in 1941, 1942, where no Jewish children were allowed to go to school. By the graciousness of the teacher, which risked her life, which is at the extreme right, sitting, her name was Judith, coming from the town of Plotsk, giving, in hiding, so to say, courses in elementary school. I would try to recall the names. From my left, a little boy by the name Baum, last name. The girl next is Warszawski. The next one, Granek. Next one, which I was very fond, and I would say that we consider today's date as a girlfriend, Zosia Neumann, the teacher Judith. Going back again from left, myself standing, my friend Steinbrecher killed, and the last name, I'm sorry, I do not remember the name anymore. I know that he had frostbites when he came back from hiding somewhere, but he got killed. None of those survived. This picture was taken in Zarki in 1941. Nothing more to say.
How old are you here?
I would say 13. I didn't speak about my great bar mitzvah. I should actually speak about it.
Would you like to tell us something now about your bar mitzvah?
Being that this picture is being taken during the time that I was really a bar mitzvah boy, I did not have any bar mitzvah, any big parties. Don't ask me how many people attended my party. It was simply the day that it was my day of bar mitzvah, I was told that I'm 13. I was given a pair of tefillin, which is, and they said to me, put it on the left hand, and they put this on your head. The next day, I did not remember which one I put on this side, and it fell off. It was I was not aware. So I hope that one day, at the reaching at the age of 83, to celebrate my second bar mitzvah.
With God's help.
This picture is taken right after the liberation in 1945. Before speaking and naming the names, I would like to start with the most outstanding one, the little baby there. This baby was saved through the monastery and orphanage, and we rescued her after the war. Now, starting from left to the right sitting position, my aunt, Sasha, the baby, and her husband, my uncle, Sam Jonish. Next, my mother, Zisel Zborowski. Standing from left to right, myself, my sisters, Sasha, my uncle Joseph, my aunt Rachel, and my brother Eli. This picture is taken in Zarki at the bunker place in the cellar, which I described before. From the picture you could see it's my sister and myself. The significance of it is that it shows you the bricks and the deep incut that you could see. That wall in the back of us is the one that was sliding and movable. This picture was taken in 1983 when the Polish-Israeli relationship was not as great as today, whereby at the City Hall in Warsaw, official presentation is being made to the daughter, Miss Jadwiga Placzek, and standing from left to right making the presentation are the three survivors from her parents, Eli, my brother, Sasha, my sister, the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Placzek, who helped us survive, and myself. This picture is of Mr. Joseph Kolacz, that's the peasant, which we were in hiding, and he rescued 10 Jews, plus 2 Jews at his sister's house for a total of 12 Jews. Mr. Kolacz came to Israel in 1987, whereby he was getting the official recognition and planted the tree and the Alley of the Righteous. His name is Josef Kolacz and myself. This is the wedding picture and our wedding day, June 20th, 1954.
Where was it taken?
This picture, we got married in the part of New York called the Bronx, and the place was the Parkside Plaza.
What is your bride's name?
My wife's name, Selina Sternlicht, now married Zborowski. This picture was taken in 1987 and at the place of Kielce, Poland, where at the time of restoration of the Jewish cemetery. Kielce has a special meaning to the Polish Jews and to the world Jewry, especially at the pogrom which was taking place in June 1946, where 50 or 60 Jews were killed merciless.
By whom?
By the Poles. This picture was taken at one of the Yad Vashem annual dinners. From left to right is Minister Arik Sharon, myself, and my brother Eli Zborowski.
Minister of which country? In which country?
Arik Sharon, minister in Israel. He had various portfolios. This picture was taken in 1992 at the Yad Vashem. At the time, I was presented of being on the board of Yad Vashem Museum in Jerusalem. The presentation was made by the honorary chairman, Secretary Joseph Burke. This picture was taken in the late 80s. With the former governor, Mario Cuomo, which I consider a good friend and at that time a neighbor as well. This is the wedding picture of our youngest son Ziggy to Galit, which was on March 15, 1992. From left to right, you could see sitting my daughter-in-law, married to my oldest son, Mark.
What's her name?
Judy. Next, Ziggy. Next, Galit, and my wife sitting. Standing, my oldest son, Mark, lovely baby, Matthew, and myself. This is Matthew, my grandson, age 5, the son of Judith and Mark Zborowski. This is my Princess Laura, the daughter of Judith and Mark Zborowski, age 2.5. This is my grandson Jeremy, the son of Galit and Ziggy Zborowski, age 2.
Mr. Zborowski, we would like to thank you very much for sharing your family album with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Zborowski, would you please introduce your family to us?
Yes, gladly. To my right, my wife. In the back of me is my oldest son, Mark. And to his right is my youngest son, Ziggy.
Mrs. Zborowski, since both you and your husband are survivors and have gone through Shoah experiences, as you look back, do you think it was easier to being married to someone who had an understanding of what you went through and you understood what your husband went through? In other words, shared experiences, did it make it easier for you to bear the burden of the Shoah?
Yes, it was. It was definitely easier.
Did you discuss the Shoah amongst you often?
Yes. Practically every Shabbos at the table, it was my husband's topic. He was telling us his stories, the children were listening, and even my daughter-in-laws, they said, so what is the topic today?
I would ask Mark, growing up in the house with parents who were survivors, did you find, speaking to your friends who did not have these experiences, did you find that you were more sensitive, brought up in a different way, or that you looked at life differently?
It's an often asked question for a myriad of reasons. But I think that growing up as a child of a survivor, you definitely do have, in my experience anyhow, there's more of a sense of family. Family being the be-all, end-all. Everything else is a clear second to life, as opposed to the life, the growing up, the childhood of friends of ours that were not children of survivors. And therefore, I definitely believe that growing up as a second generation, first generation survivor was considerably different.
Did you do any reading in the Shoah materials, in the memoirs? Do you do any reading?
I like my father, I'm a voracious reader. I don't think there are many publications that have been written that I have not read. Especially poignant is an article that I read yesterday in the Wall Street Journal about 3 new books that are actually coming out that said that the Germans who have for all these years said it was not the Germans, it was the Nazis. We did not know. I found it especially telling that in yesterday's Wall Street Journal, there was an article about this very book that is coming out that is discussing that the Germans clearly did know and they did collaborate.
Ziggy, you now have a child of your own. How do you think that being a son of survivors is going to influence upbringing of your own child, your own family?
Growing up as a child of not only one survivor, but having both parents being survivors, family was always stressed as the utmost key. And the relationship that I have with my parents as well as my brother has grown even tighter as we've grown up. And it only just will keep multiplying by sharing the joys of my son or my children or my sons to my parents and explain to them where they came from and how we're so close that we hope it'll have a rippling effect through our family as well.
Your brother Mark just mentioned the deniers in a certain way, different deniers, but anyway, how do you think, or do you think at all, about carrying on the torch to keep remembering the Kedoshim and perpetuating actually the remembrance and remembering of those who have been martyred, and of those who are still alive and are survivors?
I feel that the only way, I mean, the Yom HaShoah, the remembrance and the survivors were just as important as anything that happened in the Jewish religion years prior to my existence. And the same way with the World War II, that this existed before I was, this will be remembered as a piece of history and Jewish tradition, and they will never be forgotten.
Do you think that your parents' experiences, looking at it from as children's point of view, as being brought up by survivors, do you think that your parents were able to integrate into the society well enough, even with the scars that they are carrying?
Well, definitely. They made it a point that they wanted our children, or their children, meaning us, my brother and I, to have a better life than they had. And growing up over the years, as we were little kids, we were often always compared to our age as where they were during that time. For example, when I was 12 or my brother was 16, those were the years that my father was going through the Holocaust. So anything that we were privileged enough to get, it was always brought back, like not as something for credit, but just like when I was your age, I didn't have a bicycle or a toy or a car or whatever it was.
Mark, what is actually your hope or your dream for the future in light of the fact of the world, the way the world is right now, and all still all the things that are going on? What is your hope for the future for the world?
Well, peace would be very nice, but just to expand on that note, I think that the world should not forget the lessons of the fact that history, if we do forget, will repeat itself. Unfortunately, the crisis in Israel right now, much to the regret, I guess, of all the peace participants, seems to have stagnated at present. And I think it is very important that we as children of survivors, and human mankind do not forget what happened, what can happen. At one point, Hitler was just one raving madman. There are many of these so-called raving madmen in the world today, and like I said earlier, we should not forget what could happen if we forget our past.
Mr. Zborowski, in conclusion, would you like to add anything else, any thoughts about the Shoah or about your family? And you speak to your family.
I'd just like to stress once again the importance, and being that we're approaching now in a few weeks the day of the Yom HaShoah and many other commemorations. It's even my own lecture is being now scheduled for April 17, 1996 in Queen's College of the endowment that Selina and Marvin Zborowski made to the Queen's College. This should be stressed and it should be done and encouraged to people of all races, of all beliefs, that this should not happen again. Now, in conclusion now, to my future generation, to my own children, I'm taking great pride that they are with us. They live through the same thing. It's not easy many times to be children of survivors. And we have many shortcomings, but I would definitely say they have everything they could ask for. And I'm pleased that both my children, both my sons, and I hope that their sons will do, and their children will perpetuate the same way and be as nice and charitable as they are now. My both sons are involved and going in the footsteps of their forefathers, meaning myself and my own fathers and grandparents, of being kind and charitable in every endeavor. And this gives me great pride. Of course, their success is my success, but the investment of giving, of being kind, is the best that I could enjoy, and I hope I will be able to enjoy for many years to come. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you very much for introducing your family to us
Thank
and
you.
For sharing your experiences
Thank
with
you.
Us.
Thank you.